black people, white people. The question still remains, will we ever understand each other? Years and years go by, but we're still unable to understand the other perspective, to see things from a different point of view. Sometimes I wonder if we were ever meant to get along. Growing up, I never really thought about stuff like race relations, or even white people for that matter. In my neighborhood, there were hardly any whites around, just the brothers hanging out from the community. We always did things together. Some of the best times were at our neighborhood jams. Looking back, I realized that these were more than just parties. These were times to celebrate our culture, to celebrate who we were. My whole family's real cool. I've got great parents. And now I appreciate all the things they've done for me and my brother. They were pretty tough on me and made sure I kept up my grades. They always told me that all people are created equal and that I was no better or no less than anybody else. You know, it's kind of sad that I used to think that everybody thought that way. It's also kind of sad to see how easy it is to get messed up in this world. Man, danger's around every corner. I wanted to be somebody, and I knew that school was the tool to give me that chance. So I hit the books and finally made it to college. Even though I was glad to be here, nothing could have ever prepared me for the new world I was about to encounter. Me and my roommate had a hard time relating to each other. They had their world, and we had ours. But you know, I sometimes wonder if we don't all lose out with segregating ourselves in the long run. People just rely on stereotypes and preconceived notions to judge someone instead of getting to know the actual person inside. The result is always ignorance.
Can't.
She didn't say that.
She did. Should we lock it?
Yeah, you know how dark it gets around here.
And what the hell did you just say?
There ain't nobody talking to you, homie.
If you got something to say, say it to my face.
No, there's nothing going on here, man.
Chill.
Man, I was pissed off. Confused. Humiliated. I didn't have to hear him to know what he said. It would never matter to him that I was a college student and an honors high school student, or that my parents have respectable jobs that pay for my education. No, none of that mattered to him because all he saw in me was that I was a nigger. I just walked away, trying to figure out how things got to be so bad.
They come from small towns and big cities. Some are of modest means and some are better off than most Americans. They are African-American students attending white universities. Sooner or later, they all face the facade. A facade of truth, a facade of understanding, a facade of justice. They are led to believe, and most want to believe, that there are no problems here. The college campus, it is a place of learning. A place to grow. It is a place filled with optimism and hope. A place where dreams might come true. It is also a place where things appear better than they are. Since 1985, signs of racial intolerance and racial conflict on college campuses nationwide have been increasing. This is an alarming situation, since one would hope that places of learning would be the ideal place where different races, religions, and cultures might best be tolerated and understood. This is a story about the lives and experiences of 8 African-American students attending Indiana University in Bloomington, Indiana. It is their perspective that is most often misrepresented and most often misunderstood. It is their story that reveals the unfortunate realization that even at institutions of higher education, race still matters.
I mean, what I found is that the majority of the students that are down here, and being that they're white people, I mean, or definitely not black for that matter, all they know about black people coming from the small towns in Indiana, Indiana University is drawing largely upon the population of Indiana. You know, some of the people that are in the suburbs of Chicago and suburbs of Cincinnati and neighboring states, but they haven't had any direct exposure to black people. I mean, all they know about black people is that we can play basketball and that we dance real cool and that we do something weird to our cars and listen to loud music and things like that. And I mean, understanding now, I understand that they just didn't have any exposure to us. But instead of, you know, coming to you and asking and finding out, they would like sit back at a distance and kind of like make assumptions.
I call it my checkout counter experience, simply because it happened to me, the times that it's happened to me has been while I was at a checkout counter somewhere. I happened to be at a drugstore and I was making an early morning run for a prescription, I'll just put it that way. And as I was walking out and I was about to pay for it, the woman told me how much it cost and I looked down to write my check and she grabs my hair. Now this is a Saturday morning, I'm in a bad mood, and this woman grabs my hair and says, oh my God, this is beautiful, how do you do this? Because I had braids in my hair. Well, that's fine, but don't touch me. And since I've been in Bloomington, I think I've seen that white or Europeans take liberties with African Americans that we would never take with them. I would never walk up to someone who was white and put my hand in their hair and say anything or touch them without knowing them. And I think that whites do that. And whether they consciously know that it's a part of the structure, the racial structure that's set up in this country or not is a different issue. But for the most part, when I think about it, I attribute it to the fact that we came to this country as slaves and we're here, but to a certain extent, the country has always looked at us as second-class citizens, even though now we have certain rights and things like that. And so people feel like they can take liberties with African Americans or Hispanics or whatever that they would never do to someone else who was white.
Student life, well, I guess I kind of got off to a bad note because I had a roommate my freshman year, and her parents were from Kentucky. Her grandparents were from Kentucky, and she told me when she came in, I guess we both had our own, you know, we were always kind of set in our ways, and she told me that she only had, I think, like 3 black people in her high school, so automatically I was like, oh, hell, you know, what am I going to do, you know? So we finally got past that, but she would never outwardly call me nigger or, you know, I guess be degrading in an outward manner, but just little things that she would do showed it very obvious that she thought she was more than I was, or, you know, even though we were both paying the same room and board fee, it was her room and I was just, you know what I mean, it was my privilege to be living with her, you know, whereas it finally came down to the point where my cousins visited from Gary and they left on Sunday and she left on Wednesday, so I got my own room, so that worked out real good.
And then we got on the subject of Anthony and Cleopatra were reading that play. And I was like, you know, I raised my hand. I was like, this is an interracial play. You know, Anthony, who's from Rome, he's a white man, and Cleopatra is from Egypt. She's a black woman. She's an African. He was like, no, Cleopatra is more European. I was like, what do you mean? I said, she's African. No, I would say she's not Negroid. And I was like, wait a minute. I said, what do you mean? He's like, I wouldn't say she was Negroid. I would say she's more brown. I was like, I'm brown. What do you mean? I said, our culture goes from the very light to the very dark. I said, what do you mean? Just because she is such a figure of high establishment and everyone, you know, Cleopatra, you know what I'm saying? She can be black. I bet if I asked him, I said, you know, if the slaves or the servants in the play, were they black? Oh, yeah, sure. That's what he would have said, you know what I'm saying?
campus race relations, at least at IU, and from what I understand, on most predominantly European campuses, they're not so good. But it's not anything that disturbs me. My personal view is not so much if there's a racial incident, somebody calls me a nigger or something. I've gotten over that now with my psyche, and so personally, it doesn't bother me. I don't care if race relations are bad. I care if we're having African students come down and they're graduating and they're finding the financial backing, the cultural support networks, academic support necessary, because we have to build up ourselves before we'll even get the respect from the other community. I mean, it's a point Malcolm X makes, over and over again, and who's going to respect you, until you reach a level that demands respect and commands respect. So, maybe they don't respect us. I don't even care. We're going to make sure, I'm just going to work on my end to develop my community and give whatever I can to my community to develop so it will demand respect eventually.
Dominant culture remains unaware or unwilling to admit that racism still flourishes throughout this country. Many whites would argue that the race problem is being alleviated because blacks receive special advantages and gain employment through quota systems. Yet when viewed through the eyes of African Americans, addressing these special programs fall well short of the problems of racism. This seemingly never-ending struggle for racial justice and understanding has left many black students confused and embittered as they reevaluate and perhaps redefine their thoughts about larger society.
As far as we as a black people receiving reparations, I believe that we're entitled to it. We came over here in shackles and gave them 4 years of free labor. Bam, we need to be reimbursed, we really do, and stop being oppressed as we are. I mean, the American government reimbursed Japan for going them up. Look, Japan's at the top of the world now. They're sitting pretty. America trying to be like Japan now. Japan got it going on. But just like Germany, reimburse Germany, Koreans come to this country, they can get grants, loans, open up their businesses. I mean, how come we can't get nothing like that? How come, we as black people, we can't get no form of reparation? So I look at it like this. Somebody's going to hire you because you black, you better damn well take it. That's a form you need to, whatever, shit, take it. They owe it to you. Affirmative action, they owe us that and a lot more.
Flood relief, we see a whole country coming in sympathy of flood relief people, right? Flood, water will go down, You lost your house, you know what I mean? But in Chicago, the Taylor projects are still standing, you know what I mean? And they're going to be there forever. But I don't see no Taylor relief, you know what I mean? It's kind of funny. I mean, I understand it's immediate danger, you know what I mean? It kind of tickles me to death, the fact that, I actually gave detergent to a truck that's going out there. Well, they didn't expect it, you know what I'm saying? But, the point is that we can come to the relief of millions of people and give billions of dollars instantly to help a bad situation. Yet we have a horrible situation existing in the cities that go on day after day after day after day after day. We sit back and just say, well, those people can get jobs.
I just believe that, all white people, it's in their blood to be prejudiced and racist. I mean, it's deep within them. I don't care how much, I got friends who are, I don't care if you're green, purple, yellow, that's bull crap, man. Don't believe the hype. I mean, don't let anybody pull a coat over your face, because it's a lie. It's bullshit.
What do you think the final solution will be to the race problem?
That's a question I can't answer. I think a race war is inevitable. I think it's going to happen. Well, hopefully, if we can get ourselves prepared, if we came out on top, we can, I know it doesn't sound good, but we can do the reverse of what they did to us.
Do you think that would be right to do that?
Yeah.
Two wrongs don't make a right, you don't think, or?
I mean, what other way do we have? We done tried everything else. We done marched, we done sung, we shall overcome. We ain't overcoming nothing. Time to take some action. Like Redman said, time for some action.
Frustrated by the continual display of ignorance and indifference shown toward black people, places, and things, some students withdraw and regroup. What is primarily a friendly and nurturing environment for white students is at times a hostile and overwhelming environment for African American students, and perhaps for other minorities as well. Some students react to this environment by trying to blend in, perhaps seeking to become invisible men and women. Others react by getting involved with other students, subgroups, and organizations in an attempt to better understand and better cope with the pressure of being visibly and markedly different from the vast majority of their neighbors. all trying to find a rational way to handle irrational circumstances.
I'm a black person on a white campus. Nobody really cares about me, but maybe my fellow black students and black professors, and I need to get into the black mainstream, or I'm not gonna make it here, because nobody really cares. I became the president of my black student union in Wright Quad second semester of my freshman year, and that connected me with the whole IU black student union. That's when I started to really see that, okay, there are some other black people on campus who are leaders and who want to do something about the situation on campus.
Kim Lanice King is a graduate student who decided to take action against cultural ignorance. While writing for the school newspaper, Kim saw a chance to present a perspective she felt had been traditionally neglected.
In my columns, I wanted to address the feelings that I had based on a lot of the racial incidents that occurred on campus. And also to address some of the myths that white people have about what blacks experience on a predominantly white campus. And I think for the most part, most whites would say that they're not aware of racism, or that racism doesn't exist, or that if it does, it's just an isolated incident and not everyone thinks that way. I think for the most part, that's what white people would say, and I've actually heard white people say that. And so in my column, I talked about how I feel and how I experience Bloomington, which is it's in southern Indiana. There are places where the Klan is very active nearby. So I address that, how I feel about being in what I perceive to be a hostile environment that is predominantly white. And in the context of that, there are certain words that I use and a certain dialect that I use when I'm speaking with African Americans. Well, in my columns, although I was trying to let whites know how I felt about my existence and the things I had heard about other African Americans on campus, I also used the dialect that I would use with African Americans. It used to be called black dialect. It's also been called phonetic spelling. You spell it the way you say it. And I happen to not say sister when I'm talking to African Americans. I usually say, what's up, sister, or something like that. And so the spelling for me when I'm communicating with African Americans is S-I-S-T-A-H. And that was a lot of things that pissed a lot of people off. On campus, that was one of the things that people really reacted to, saying that that's not a word. I looked in the dictionary and it's not there. And so the response from African Americans was, you looked in a white dictionary. And that essentially means that you looked in a dictionary that doesn't encompass the existence of African Americans. It doesn't reflect the different types of words that we use in our day-to-day life when interacting with our own people. And by the same token, I was totally taken aback. People got so upset that I would spell a word the way I used it. And just because it didn't agree with how they spell things, it was wrong. I mean, and that is what is upsetting to me, is that in this society, or particularly in Bloomington, if you do things that are different, it's bad, or inferior, or wrong. It can't just be different.
At times, campus life seems to occupy parallel space, running along side by side, two worlds never meeting, one white and diverse, one black and diverse. While very few seem to understand and respect the significance of the differences.
Coming from Columbia, even though it was a suburb, there were a lot of blacks there, there were a lot of Asians, there were a lot of Latinos, and just a lot of different ethnic backgrounds. And even though the same is true for here, we don't mix a lot. At home, we mixed a lot. We all went out together and so forth. Whereas at IU, you know, the blacks hang together, the whites hang together. And if you cross that line, it's always, you know, everybody's always wondering why. Like, if you go to a black party and see a white person there, it's like, oh, Lord, there's the white girl looking for a black guy, you know. And when you go to a white party, like I went to one white party once since I've been here, and it felt like the party stopped. You know what I mean? It's not like you don't feel welcomed at all. Even though there is some separatism within the black community here at IU, there is some togetherness also. And on the weekends, I feel like I can go to a black party and have fun. I can go to a black frat house to a party, you know. I can go to somebody's apartment who's, you know, it's not, I don't have to hang out with a bunch of white people to feel like I have something to do. I always feel like I have a black community to go to.
To explain the cultural difference between blacks and whites, I would say black people have a culture. I'm not saying white people don't have a culture, it's just that black culture is so dominating that white people tend to want to be part of that culture. They want to dip in, they don't really want to wear the shoes, they just want to kind of wear them for a little bit, then come, you know, take them off. Wear them for a little bit, then take them off. You know, they kind of like, this is what I see, you know, in my personal opinion, I think they kind of like the way we carry ourselves. I mean, we create styles of our own. I mean, we created music, and they like that. They want to dip into it, but they don't want to be black. They, not quite, you know.
I do think that white people have a tendency to look at a good thing that comes out of the black community and trivialize it, dilute it.
One thing white people don't understand is, they just don't try to understand us. They try to mimic us and stuff. I mean, I don't like to be mimicked. You know what I'm saying? I don't know these guys' names, but I see a couple of white dudes on campus. You know, they try to be black. What's up, man? You know, you can't be that. I mean, that like, I'm like, damn, that's us. Why are you trying to step into something that's not you? I mean, you supposed, you know, stay your normal white, you know, in that range. You don't try to come out. And when he goes home, he doesn't say, what's up, mom, you know? What's up, mama? Like we say mama, you know, stuff like that. He might say, he go home, he's like, how you doing, mom? You know, he don't say, what's up, mom? Chilling, you know, and stuff like that. That hurts me. I offends the hell out of me. I hate that shit. I mean, I do. I hate it.
I don't think that we should allow our culture to be diluted. I don't, that doesn't mean we shouldn't share it, but I think that when we share it, we need to make people understand this is something sacred. This is something that to me means something. So please don't go out and do it because it's not a compliment anymore. It's a joke.
Separation, integration, segregation, nationalism. The fine lines of distinction that blur and confuse these concepts have been argued since America developed its structure and rationale for slavery. From Frederick Douglass to Booker T. Washington, from W.E.B. Du Bois to Marcus Garvey, all of these great leaders knew that the right to choose from among these perspectives is an American right. The use of force to allow for the right to choose your companions, your neighborhoods, your associations, is not the same as the use of force to eliminate the possibility of such choices. This distinction is sometimes lost in the fog of paranoia and guilt inherent in the practice of racism in America. As we hear...
I'm a separatist.
Are you? Tell me why you are.
I'm a separatist because integration is killing off our people. It's not doing us any good. As long as we integrate, we're just killing off each other and shooting each other and our minds are corrupt and everything. It's not doing our race any good. I think we're too sprouted out. And then we get brainwashed, or some cases whitewashed. And I think we lose contact of where we got to go, focus on what we need to do. And when the more people move out and get separated, they just get, you know, fluctuated with all kinds of stuff, and they just lose sight of what their purpose is, you know, or what they need to do for their people.
I think, when I think about integration in the civil rights era, I think that it might not have been the best recourse for African Americans. Most African Americans aspire to moving into the white suburbs. That's the pinnacle of success. And in doing so, they escape from their roles in their community. In reality, our lawyers and our doctors and our educators and our politicians lived in the same community that the people who were on welfare, the people who were working class, lived in that community as well. And so it was easier to move from one class to another because kids had role models. Even if their parents weren't the best role models for them, there were avenues. There were also, when my parents talk about where they grew up, it was very tight-knit. Everybody's parents talk about how when you were messing up, you got your butt kicked by the neighbor who saw you, the relatives that you met on the way home, and then your parents kicked your butt. So that everybody was involved in the rearing of their children of the community. It wasn't just, this is so-and-so's child. It was, this is the community's responsibility to raise our children. So in a lot of ways, I think integration is responsible for, not completely responsible, but has played a part in the decline of the urban areas that are predominantly black. I think it also has contributed to the decline of self-esteem of African Americans in a holistic sense.
I think it's a limited and narrow view, and I think a lot of people who denounce black nationalism, black separatism, whatever they want to call it, I show their vanity when they try to say that, you know, they're separating it and there's nothing good. Well, when we have our own institutions, they can and maintain the African integrity within that institution, our style, our values, our way of thinking, they can learn from that, you know, and they don't really recognize the fact that we have something to offer them. And it's really frustrating. I don't think, I have no problem with separatism. And I think that when you talk separatism, you know, I mean, they don't understand that, I don't care, you know, I'm not saying separate where I can't, you know, go to the restroom next to you or sit next to you, but we're gonna have our own institutions, and it's no different than any other communities. Jewish communities have their own institutions, own networks, you know. Italian communities, Irish American communities, you know, you never hear any questions about that. But as soon as black people start wanting to build up their own institutions, they tag it separatism and make it an evil, ugly word, you know. And separatism is not ugly, you know, it's what everybody else is doing.
Many whites have argued that blacks are further aggravating the race problem by having their own groups and organizations. It is interesting how quickly they overlooked the many years blacks were denied access to most organizations, job opportunities, and schools. This mistakenly allows many to draw the conclusion that everything different from the majority culture is therefore inferior. But in the words of James Brown, a dull knife just ain't cutting.
I didn't know what it was that I was feeling, but I began to develop, for lack of a better term, an attitude. I mean, really, that I mean, I was really resenting the fact that everywhere I went, I was looked at as not just, you know, chance, but a black guy, or I have a black guy in my class. People were like befriending me more so because they weren't exposed to black people, and I found myself answering the questions of, you know, that they've had all their life. Why do black people do this, and why do black people do that? And, you know, the biggest question that kept coming over and over again is like, you know, you're in the black culture, and I can't believe they have a black culture center here. It's like, I'm not prejudiced or anything, they would say to me, but I don't understand why there's a black culture center. I mean, it's like, if there was a white culture center, everybody would be so upset. And I'm like, well, IU kind of is a white culture center, and the fact that, you know, what is it, like 3.5-4% black people down here at IU, and, you know, basically, when they, you know, have bowling and things like that, or they have films that brought here, and, you know, the dancing clubs they have, and there's four, you know, fours are the square dancing club, there's a square dancing club here, and the spelunking club, and the skydiving club, and, hiking, and backpacking, and biking, and I don't know one black person who's ever, even knows what spelunking is, or has ever been skydiving, or has ever been scuba diving, and it's like, and they're going to sit here and tell me that, you know, there's no such thing as a white culture center.
With this being a predominantly white university, I don't, you have to have some kind of group that helps you stay with your own. We need that support system. Like I said, when I came down here, I felt like, you know, it was just me against the world. You go to a lecture hall where you're 200 students and you're just one in the number, especially one black in the number. When I came down here, there was a white Delta, there was a white student in the black gospel choir that I was in. It's like, why do we have to justify wanting to have groups of our own, and why do they always have to come in? I mean, they always have to intercede because we're not readily accepted into their white fraternities and white sororities, and nobody makes them justify why they have 25 fraternities and 32 sororities, or, you know, whatever the numbers may be. So if we want to form the Black Student Union, so be it.
The reason why blacks congregate together, and some whites have a problem with that, they think that we're segregating ourselves. It's like, we go to class all day, and we're around them. I mean, it's a white man's world, so we're around them all day. So sometimes, just like in the cafeteria, when I used to live in the dorm, and you saw all the black people, we sit together. I mean, that's our time. I mean, we want to bind together and have that connection, because some white people, they just can't understand where we're coming from. You know, you might say something like, I'm hip. And they're like, well, what's I'm hip? You know, I know, you know, it means I know translated, or, you know, or chill, you know, or anything, you know what I'm saying? Just kick it. And that's just a time for us to be us, you know, and don't have to translate nothing, just be us and kick it and cool it, you know what I'm saying?
My honest to goodness feeling is that black people need a chance to stop and realize, hey, I'm black. I have some history, I have some heritage that I don't know about. And unfortunately, I have not been able to control the system, control the educational system, the economic system, the system. I have not been able to control it or even have input so that I would be able to know about my heritage or my history. So I think especially at the college level, we start to realize that, hey, now I can control something, if nothing less than my class schedule. So I want to take Afro-American study classes. I want to be able to find out about my history and about my heritage. I think that black student unions, the NAACP, black Greeks, all of those help as kind of a supplement to courses that you might take in Afro-American studies. And I think that that's what the black student unions do. I think they allow us to stop and say, let me look around. Let me look around at me. What's making up me? And that allows me as a black student, especially on a predominantly white campus, to walk around and feel more comfortable about myself. Yeah, I may be the only black person in this class, but I know that there's a whole entourage of black students on this campus who's a part of my black student union, and I know that my heritage tells me that I come from a long line of people who survived, and so I can survive.
I even went through that thing where I wanted, you know, maybe not to be white, but as close as I could get to it, you know, with the curly hair and the green eyes and light skin, because when I was a freshman, that was like the thing, you know, guys were like, I want a red bone, you know, and I was nowhere near it, you know. So I always wanted to be as close to white as I can be, just for the sake of acceptance. And then my freshman year, I met a woman named Sadie Lonson. She was my freshman world history teacher. And she used to tell me, you know, why do you want to be so white or whatever? And she took me through all kinds of history. And she was the first teacher that I had that would go through and teach us about King Tut and Queen Hatshepsut and Cleopatra, and then would make a note to say, and she was black, you know, and let me know it's fine to be black. As a matter of fact, it's part of your greatness.
To me, all music doesn't have to paint pictures. I mean, some music exists for itself. But I think that music ought to make people, it ought to be like a vocal motion picture. I think when you sing Chariot Roll on the Mountaintop, somebody ought to see mountains. See what I'm saying? Somebody ought to see a chariot. You know? Somebody ought to see that by the way you sing it. You need to see it first. You need to see it first. Chariot Roll on the Mountaintop. Jesus spoke and the chariot stopped. Chariot didn't move another inch. I have to have that picture before I can sing it right. I have to have that picture before I can sing it right. And I don't have to, I know that if I sing this as a solo, I'd make you say, go ahead, make that chariot stop. And that's what you got to do.
So now, much to the frustration of some African Americans, whites seem to feel that the exclusion of virtually all references to the historical and cultural influences of their ancestors on America is only a minor problem. However, this void, this educational black hole, goes far and beyond inconvenience as we see young African Americans struggle, as they find that they must search far and wide for the self-esteem that comes with the knowledge of self. Sometimes is a painful and lonely quest that has been trivialized in its importance by the American educational establishment.
I didn't know who I was as a black man and what I was supposed to do. So I found out there's an African-American department down here. I was like, word up, you know, I'm going into it. So I started taking classes and learning about who I was, where my people come from. Like in high school, only thing you're gonna learn is, well, you were slaves and then there's Martin Luther King. Being black on a predominantly white campus, you must, priority, find your identity as a black person. You got to find your roots.
you know, being friends with blacks, you know, black males down here and black females and stuff wasn't just good enough for me anymore. I mean, I had to prove to myself the blackness. I had to go out of the extreme. I had to make up for all of my high school years. I had to make up for all the junior high years when I was forced to, like, look at, you know, the Joneses next door, the Smiths next door, and look at the fact that he got a brand new car and he was 16 and he was doing white things and, you know, compete with them on a social level and still competed quite well, you know, I might add, but, you know, I had to make up for that, you know what I'm saying? I was finding, you know, essentially myself, and finding the fact that, you know, besides the fact that I was mixed, doesn't make a difference if I was mixed or a quarter black, I'm not white, and that's what it came down to. They don't care if you're light-skinned, dark-skinned, you know, half and half, you know, whatever they called me, whatever the day was, it's, I wasn't white, and they would never let me forget that fact, and I didn't want to forget that fact either. I got to the point where I took, you know, my pride and my interest in finding out what it was like to be a black youth, you know, like, I took it to heart. It became a mission for me. And I mean, anything I could do that was black, I was a part of it.
In terms of people who are in high school, I think we as a community have to realize why the history of education in this country. Compulsory education at the K through 12 was not created to educate us. It was created to help us to assimilate into society. So knowing that, when you send your children to school, you need to realize that there's an aspect to education necessary for African Americans that's not going to happen in the classroom, even though, or despite the fact that their teachers may be African American. I did not read Malcolm X, the autobiography of Malcolm X, in high school. I read very little black literature in high school, and I am from Gary, which is predominantly black. In grade school, they celebrate Black History Month, and then that's it. So the bulk of education that is necessary for black children to grow up with pride about who they are, their cultural pride, has to come from their parents. Most kids don't come to predominantly white schools knowing how to deal with racism. And usually if you're in some place like Gary, you really don't have to learn how to deal with that. Because unless you go to certain areas, you won't really see a racial incident, or you won't have anyone be negative to you. And if you do, usually your parents are there and they've grown up with it so they can do that for you. In college, if you don't give kids enough cushion, or enough self-esteem, enough pride when they get out of high school, they're not going to be able to make it in college.
The journey toward self-discovery has been a unique and difficult one for Pete Pletcher. Pete was adopted by a white family and had a hard time understanding his culture.
European background, adopted into a white family, fairly prominent, well-known in the community, and, you know, pretty much dominated with European friends, you know, grew up on country club scene type stuff, and basically my identity was completely absent, you know, or it was fulfilled with a European identity. You know, I had a slave mentality, I would say a house slave mentality maybe, and thought everybody could, you know, get over if they wanted to. And was easily influenced by, you know, my socialization was with the European friends, and, you know, they'd say something and you'd think, well, yeah, I don't understand why these other black people just don't, you know, don't raise themselves up, you know what I'm saying? You know, and it was, I was so brainwashed, it was like, you know, to have somebody, you always hear about, you know, like see it on TV or somebody, you know, when somebody lets nigger slip and they say, oh, well, you know, I don't mean you, you know, and I'd be, you know, I was fine with that. Yeah, I'm no nigger, you know, that kind of attitude. The whole attitude when I went to college was something that I had cultivated, you know, in my high school years, which is one of not really caring, you know, no self-respect. And it was evident as soon as I got down to school. I mean, I was drunk my first 21 days, right? I mean, I just wanted to escape. You know, I was very much into escapism, which is totally contradictory to my views now. But at that time, you know, I mean, I was drunk, I was being foul, you know, looking to get with the women and stuff. And the interesting thing that was difficult was in Elkhart, I came from a community where I was known, and it was easy to let little slights go, you know what I'm saying? They didn't affect me so much. And I got taken out of that environment and put into the hostile IU, you know, big university. You know, I did have a lot of friends go down there, but they went there, you know, they went in a certain direction, you know, a lot into the white Greek system and all that stuff. I mean, I even entertained thoughts of going in there, you know, and that's pretty scary, you know what I'm saying, from what I know now. My sister, who was a senior at IU at that time, was finishing up, she had a class, a speech class, where she, you know, had to pick a topic, and she chose South Africa's educational system. And she read a book called Kaffir Boy by Mark Mathabane, a young African who got to the United States and really struggled. And she was always pushing on me to read the book and made me feel a little guilty. I'm thinking, well, I need to, you know, she's taking an interest in my own people, right? And I'm not even, you know, I've never taken interest myself. So I'm finally, after a semester of pushing, she finally got me inspired enough to go check out a book and read. And I did the reading on Martin Luther King, because that was the only place I knew where to start. I mean, he's the only dude I knew. I mean, Martin Luther King, We Shall Overcome. You know, outside of that, there was nothing. And so I went ahead. It was during Little 500 Week, which is the party weekend at IU. And I was partying with the best of them. And I came home drunk and wasn't tired. So I went ahead and broke out Martin Luther King's book. You know, I started reading. This is probably about 1 o'clock in the morning. You know, come about 6 o'clock in the morning, I had that, put that thing down, and I was done. You know, there's no stopping me. And it just made me realize the power of this man, this African man, you know what I'm saying? And I was just, it was total awakening for me, you know, a pleasant awakening, not a rude awakening. I mean, it just shocked me to know that there was such a strong African man, you know, that I couldn't believe this guy was hidden from me. And I started to say, what else is out there? You know, what else? You know, I mean, it gave me instant self-respect, instant self-esteem. And so at that point, you know, I started to really get involved. I tried to read, pay closer attention. I get a better understanding of what it meant to be black in the United States. You know, where our roots were, how our past is still inextricably tied to our present and will be tied to our future. And so I started to read, and wasn't growing too fast, but it was definitely the seeds were planted. And that fall, when I came back, I finally broke out Malcolm X's autobiography. Now, you think Martin Luther King hit me hard. Okay, multiply that, you know, times 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And it just, there was no turning back at that point. I mean, Malcolm X, you know, struck a nerve with me.
Despite Pete's struggle to discover his African-American heritage, he has no regrets being adopted into a white family that has provided a good life for him.
You know, I don't hold any hostility towards Europeans in general, you know, too much so, I guess. I mean, I think I'd be crazy not to to have some bias there. But my family is my family, you know what I'm saying? And it's just like, you know, it's my brother, If he shows his ignorance, you know, I call him out. You know, but everybody knows it doesn't matter who, if they're European, your family, you can call out a little bit stronger than you can anybody else, and you still love them. So I don't have any regrets. It's a little work.
Many black students do not carry a very receptive attitude towards whites as other blacks do. Black students must realize that prejudice can be a two-way street, that one cannot expect justice without acting just themselves. In many cases, these young people are much too hard on each other, at times labeling one another as sellouts or as too white based upon superficial assessments.
My mother, you know, was my sole provider growing up. My father didn't come along in my life till I was 12 or 13. She told us, you know, we watched Roots, and she gave us understanding about being black. But at the same time, she didn't stress, don't like white people because, you know, they did this to us. She would stress, you do what you got to do to get by, you'll have your friends, but you got to get yours, because no one's not going to give it to you. So basically, ever since she told me that, the rest of my life, I've stuck to that motto. I don't judge anyone because of their color, and I go about my life trying to what's make best for me, and then I take care of my family. Well, before I came to Indiana University, you know, I was in the military. I was under this frame of mind of working 8 hours a day and, you know, doing the regular military stuff. And so my image about college was, it's a diversity thing. You go in there, everybody's getting along. I know there's racism everywhere, but you figure college, the way you see the image on TV in America and from other people, is that this is a place where everybody comes together and gets along, puts their ideals together, and work together.
The setting I grew up in, I went to all white schools all my life. I mean, literally all my life. I went to Edgewood Elementary School, out in the boonies. There are no blacks, okay? I was the only one in every grade. I was the only black person. And people always say, yeah, you know, you called on the phone and I didn't know you were black, you sounded white on the phone. And I always ask them, so what does sounding white, what does that mean? To me, I think I speak eloquently. And I think that it's important to be able to get your point across. And if you can't speak well, and when I say well, I think we have to go on the white stream standard, you know, and that's reality. In economics, and even in the social realm, you've got to be able to get your point across.
And I know that there is a prejudice within the race. Just from my own personal experiences, there's a prejudice, if you are an articulate, intelligent black person as opposed to a down ghetto, what's up, you know what I'm saying? There's just a difference. There's the prejudice there. There's the us and them. There's the us and them if I'm light and you're dark, if my hair is long and your hair is short, you know, as females, you know, if I'm tall and you're short. I don't know why we are like that, but I think it's more within our race than outside of our race.
You know, and one of the things that I tried to talk to a lot of black people about when I was in the military, and especially since I've been in college, since I've learned more about myself and about being a black person, is that we're all black by race, but that doesn't mean we're all gonna be the same. We all gotta come together sometime in our minds to help each other, but we grow up in different areas, in different classes, and go through different heritages as black people. So you can't judge each other to be how you are.
I don't know why it exists because, you know, as I heard someone else say, you know, we're just all out here fronting. I mean, basically we are. We're all black. We're all here for the same reason. We're all down for the same cause, or at least we should be. So why is everybody, you know, trying to sport this front or this facade as is often called? I mean, we're just, I don't know, you know, it should be I'm black and you're black, period.
Well, the pro-black model that I've started to learn about and understand about, and you do have that stigma that if you don't wear your hat backwards, if you're not listening to rap music, if you're not wearing an African symbol, then you're not pro-black. And I don't think that should be always true, because there are black people that work in businesses and have to wear a suit and tie. Just because they don't wear that certain stigma or stereotype, that doesn't mean they're not a pro-black person. And I think people have to understand, what does pro-black really mean? You know, if you have to say you're pro-black all the time, what are you really saying about yourself? Because in a way, you know, being pro-black, you know, can go different ways. It can be from studying your history, doing what's best to make yourself better in this society when you're a minority, you know, or is it dressing pro-black or listening to all pro-black music? You know, what is that supposed to fit into? It can all come together, or it can be whatever a person wants to make it. But it's for me, the most important thing far as a pro-black has to go to should be in the mind and the way they carry themselves.
Hope is the foundation upon which education is built. In the African-American community, there is an almost blind faith that education will automatically lead to justice. There is a firm notion that higher education in particular should be free of the everyday common racist attacks, big and small, intentional and accidental, that seem to follow African Americans around like white shadows, ghosts of the racist past.
If you're an uneducated black person and you come up against some educated white people, they're gonna swamp you, man. Put all kind of stuff on you, and you'll be like, I'm lost, I don't understand, you know what I'm saying?
You know, we kind of get discouraged, you know, you come down here, and it's like, and you, like, every day, same old routine, you know, white, all you ever see is white people, you're measured up against white people, you know, and you kind of just lose sight of that sometimes, you kind of get frustrated, you're kind of like, why am I doing this, you know, you're sick and tired of it, and, you know, sometimes, you know, as soon as you step out of the campus, as soon as you, you know, walk by the business school, and you see a bunch of white people sitting around, you know, looking at you kind of funny, or you hear someone tell a black joke, it reminds you, that's why. You know, you do it, you know, partly for every reason everybody else goes to college. You know, you want to better yourself, but also because you feel like you have an obligation to yourself and to your family and to black people in general that, you know, if we have an opportunity, we would not only be foolish for throwing it away, but it would be detrimental to us. It would be so counterproductive that it couldn't even begin to measure, you know. So we have to. It's not a matter of, like, you know, when or how. It's just a matter that we have to succeed. We have to graduate from Indiana. We have to graduate from a college. We have to get ourselves a degree. We have to place ourselves in prominent roles in society so that we can be looked upon as role models. You know?
But as a whole, I have loved it here. I have grown so much. I've come into consciousness of myself as a Black person and then just as a person, period. You know, there's such a diversity of people here. You can do or get involved in just about anything. I have loved Indiana University. I wouldn't have picked any other school. You know, even I sometimes think I should have gone to a historically Black or college or predominantly Black school, but I think that Indiana University represents society as a whole. You know, it's a predominantly white school, but it's a predominantly white world.
Well, as far as the influence, I think universities can do for Black students. For one, you're expanding your mind. I mean, hundreds of years ago, probably 40 years ago, Black people didn't have the chance to get education. 100 years ago, they weren't even allowed to. You were beaten or killed if you were caught reading. So the chance for Black people to go to schools at these entities like Indiana University, it's a Big Ten school. You know, good education is going to take you a far way in this country if you use it right. And it is helping other Black people, you know, get through something. We don't all have the chance to go to a historical Black school, but going to a school that has majority white students isn't going to downplay a Black student. It's going to help them because they have a chance to interact with white people and help them get over their fears about being prejudiced. You need that. You just can't segregate yourself totally. You do need segregation to a point. But then again, if we're living in a country where we're the minority and they're the majority, how can you help the problem if you don't help each other?
So students show up every year full of the hope that the world will be made better if they learn and grow in their college years. If they stop coming, if they give up hope, then America will become an awful place. Because there is something of value to be had from Indiana University. And Indiana University and other great American institutions will have been made better places for having had these young people on campus. We urge more and more young people like the ones we have shown to attend more and more of our nation's universities, and our nation will understand that these young people deserve more than the old and destructive notion that some people are better than others simply because they are different from others.